Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to the ICICI Lombard General Insurance Company Limited Q1 FY22 earnings conference call. From the senior management, we have with us today Mr. Bhargav Dasgupta, MD and CEO of the company, Mr. Gopal Balachandran, CFO and CRO, Mr. Sanjeev Mantri, Executive Director Retail, Mr. Alok Agarwal, Executive Director Wholesale. Please note that any statements, comments are made in today's call that may look like forward-looking statements are based on information presently available to the management and do not constitute an indication of any future performance. As future involves risks and uncertainties which could cause results to differ materially from the current views being expressed. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Bhargav Dasgupta, MD and CEO, ICICI Lombard General Insurance Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Good evening to each one of you. Thank you for joining the conference call of ICICI Lombard General Insurance for quarter one of FY22. Hope you and your colleagues are safe and healthy. First and foremost, allow me to offer prayers and thoughts to those who have lost their lives to COVID-19. Let me also appreciate the hard work and the dedication of all healthcare and frontline workers, and particularly our employees, for relentlessly working during such turbulent times. I will give you a brief overview of the industry trends and developments that we have witnessed in the last few months, followed by emerging demand trends and opportunities. Post this, our CFO, Mr. Gopal Balachandran, will share the financial performance of the company for the quarter ended June 30, 2021. The second wave of the pandemic in our country that peaked in May 2021 has been devastating and much steeper than the first wave that peaked in September last year, consequently derailing the growth recovery that had commenced in the second half of last year. However, the pace and scale of vaccinations, along with the fact that lockdowns are localized, is expected to help the revival of growth, though there continues to remain challenges for the economy to reach a level of potential growth this year, given the risk of a third wave, disrupted supply chains, aggregate consumer demands, and the large contraction still seen in certain specific sectors. Turning to the GI industry, during this quarter, motor insurance saw muted growth due to two consecutive years of slowdown, leading to a lower base for retention and postponement of motor insurance due to restricted mobility due to COVID-19 induced lockdown in some parts of the country. Health insurance, on the other hand, continued to show robust growth for the industry, which was driven by enhanced awareness due to the pandemic and an attitude shift of consumers towards protection buying. As far as commercial lines are concerned, the growth in the fire segment moderated on a higher base, while marine and engineering lines witnessed some pickup due to the base effect. Overall, as per disclosures on the website of IRDAI, the general insurance industry registered a growth of 13.8% on Q1 of FY2022 over Q1 of 2021, with the industry GDPI moving up to 444.35 billion rupees in Q1 of this year from 390.55 billion in Q1 of FY2021. During the quarter, we continued to face headwinds in the form of elevated COVID health claims, no revision in prevailing motor third-party tariff rates, and cat events. Speaking of our experience, the recent COVID-19 wave has been challenging and very different from the one last year. Operationally, we were better prepared for remote working and seamless delivery of operations and continued to prioritize employee health and safety. In spite of that, over 10% of our employees got affected with the virus, and we lost 16 of our colleagues. We provided COVID-19 helpline for any support and advice for COVID-19 affected employees or their family members, among other employee benefits, which included doctor consultation, bed requirement, insurance-related support, home care reimbursement, salary advance, and additional leave, among others, thus positively impacting over 2,300 lives. We also undertook a pan-India vaccination drive that began in June for our employees and their family members. I'm happy to share that over 80% of our employees have been vaccinated till date, at least with one jab. Turning to the business impact during the quarter, firstly, the main challenge during the second wave was significantly higher number of reported COVID-19 claims and the longer reporting tail than what we witnessed in the first, in wave one. Although the average stay period had come down during the second wave, the moderate and critical cases had substantially increased, and so did the cost of stay in these cases. Also, unlike the first wave, the second wave impacted affluent class having better insurance.
Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Gupta. We cannot hear you, sir.
Yeah. Let me just check.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stay connected while we check the line of the management. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for patiently holding. The line of the management is connected back. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Sorry about that. I believe my voice was not coming through clearly. I covered some of the impact that we saw for our employees, and I was talking about the business impact when I think I got disconnected. So I'll turn back to the business impact during this quarter. So the main challenge during the second wave that we saw was significantly higher number of reported COVID-19 claims, overall cases, and the longer reporting tail than what we witnessed in wave one. Although the average stay period had come down during the second wave, the moderate and critical cases had substantially increased, and so did the cost of stay in these cases. Also, unlike the first wave, the second wave impacted the affluent class having better insurance penetration and higher sum assured. Taking you through the claims pattern for the overall industry, COVID-19 claims reported for quarter one of this year has already crossed 1 million in comparison to 0.98 million cases in the whole of last financial year, of which 4% of the claims were reported with us. Secondly, the claim frequency of elective surgeries during the quarter saw a lower dip in comparison to what we saw last year, although the number of claims continues to remain marginally below the pre-COVID levels. And thirdly, the motor own damage claim frequency had a lower reduction as we had a local lockdown in some states, unlike a complete nationwide lockdown that we saw during the same period last year. As a result, the benefit that we received on account of motor OD this year was lower in comparison with what we saw last year. And the reserving philosophy for us has remained the same, which is spreading any benefit on account of favorable development over a period, whereas taking any hit due to unfavorable development on an immediate basis. Now, while we were cautious on underwriting group health portfolio during the last quarter, we remain excited about the long-term opportunity in the health insurance segment. For us, retail health will continue to be one of the fastest growing segments, and we will keep investing and expanding product lines driven by consumer needs, enhancing digital and people capabilities, and strengthening distribution engine. Towards this, we plan to further strengthen our headcount by adding another 1,000 people in the retail health sales force. Now, given the recent adverse experience on loss ratios under the health portfolio due to the second wave of COVID-19, in order to make the book sustainable in the longer run, we have started to increase the average premium per life for a given exposure in the group employee health segment. We have been effecting increase in average premium per life in ranges of 15 to 20% in consultation with the channel partners and clients based on their past claims experience, as well as keeping in mind the COVID-19 pandemic is far from over. Our long-standing investment in technology was accelerated last year, resultantly with over 97.3% of our policies being issued by us for the quarter ended 2022 was in paperless form. Under the SME segment, close to 90% of the business sourcing were through these digital solutions. Our holistic insurance and wellness app, I'll Take Care, that is curated to provide a gamut of healthcare and insurance services, has surpassed 7 lakh downloads. Our objective is to get closer to our customers by providing a unique platform for continuous engagement to help them take care of their health, motor, and other risks. At the outbreak of the second wave, as a socially responsible organization, we took several timely measures in providing support to the community at large. We supplied 1,000 oxygen concentrators across select locations that had witnessed a rapid increase of COVID-19. We partnered with a leading hospital to set up a 58-bed dedicated COVID care center in Newtown, West Bengal. We organized free vaccination drives for the underprivileged citizen in Mumbai. Over 10,000 such vaccinations have been completed as part of this initiative so far, with a plan being to vaccinate a total of 50,000 individuals at the earliest. We are also providing free vaccination and COVID-19 test support to 2,500 senior citizens. While these are small efforts in the larger context, we believe that collectively India Inc. can play a crucial role in mitigating the impact of the pandemic. As we speak, the extent and impact of the third wave, if any, of the pandemic continues to loom. We are only hopeful that we will never have to go through the experience that we had over the last 3 months, not just as a company, but as a country. For us at ICICI Lombard, we have built over the years a well-diversified portfolio mix that positions us to uniquely capitalize on the present conditions. We are confident about our ability to grow our business in preferred segments and continue to create long-term value for our shareholders. We continue to maintain strong capital position and strengthened reserves even during the challenging times. I will now request Gopal to take you through the financial numbers for the recently concluded quarter.
Thanks, Bhargav, and good evening to each one of you. I will now give you a brief overview of the financial performance of the company for Q1 FY22. We have put up the results presentation on our website. You can access it as we walk you through the performance numbers. Our gross direct premium income of the company stood at Rs. 37.33 billion in Q1 FY22. As compared to Rs. 33.02 billion in Q1 FY21, a growth of 13%. This was largely in line with the industry growth of 13.8%. Our focus on preferred segments primarily drove our GDPI growth. The fire segment registered GDPI growth of 12.7% in Q1 FY22, thereby catalyzing the GDPI growth of our property and casualty segment. The growth in this segment has normalized, consequent to the rate hike that happened in January 2020. As indicated in our results presentation, the overall property and casualty segment grew by 18.6% in Q1 FY22 over Q1 FY21. On the retail side of the business, in the motor segment, we registered a muted growth of 1.9% in Q1 FY22. Individual health indemnity business grew by 20.4% for Q1 FY22. Our SME segment delivered 21.3% growth for Q1 FY22. To harness the potential of this segment, we have been expanding our distribution network to increase penetration in Tier 3 and Tier 4 cities. Our agents, which include the point of sale, increased to 61,385 as at June 30, 2021, up from 59,545 as on March 31, 2021. The advance premium was Rs. 32.11 billion as at June 30, 2021, from Rs. 32.06 billion as at March 31, 2021. Combined ratio increased to 121.3% in Q1 FY22 compared to 99.7% in Q1 FY2021. The combined ratio includes, as per actuarial practice, assumption of thick tail of claims to factor delay in reporting of health claims. The combined ratio includes impact of COVID claims on health book of rupees 6.02 billion, of which 3.84 billion of claims were incurred, and claims incurred but not reported, IBNR provisions was 2.18 billion rupees in Q1 FY22, as against 0.20 billion in Q1 FY2021 and rupees 3.39 billion in the whole of FY2021. The reasons for the combined ratios to be elevated for this quarter are, as Bhargav spoke, significant surge in COVID cases intimated from just about 1300 cases in Q1 FY2021 and about 50,000 cases for the whole of FY2021 to about 46,000 cases just for quarter 1 FY2022. As mentioned by Bhargav, non-COVID health claims count saw a sharp rise of 111.8% in this quarter 1 FY2022 as compared to Q1 FY2021. While we saw some benefit on motor, however, the benefit was lower than what we saw during the same period last year. There was an increase in motor OD claims count 75% in Q1 FY2022 as compared with Q1 FY2021. Cyclone and flood losses increased to 0.38 billion in Q1 FY22 as compared to 0.35 billion in Q1 FY2021. Our investment assets rose to rupees 320.75 billion at June 30, 2021 as compared to rupees 308.92 billion at March 31, 2021. Investment leverage net of borrowings was 4.16 times at June 30, 2021 as compared to 4.09 times at March 31, 2021. Investment income increased to rupees 7.23 billion in Q1 FY22 as compared to rupees 4.99 billion in Q1 FY21. Our capital gain was at rupees 2.44 billion in Q1 FY22 as compared to rupees 0.61 billion in Q1 FY21. Our mark-to-market gain on the investment portfolio was at rupees 15.26 billion at June 30, 2021. This number was 14.13 billion at March 31, 2021 and 10.66 billion at June 30, 2020. The company has exercised the call option to redeem the debentures of 4.85 billion in full, along with the final interest due, which is post the receipt of the necessary regulatory or statutory approvals on July 28, 2021. The record date for the same was July 12, 2021. Our profit before tax stood at rupees 2.02 billion in Q1 FY22 as compared to rupees 5.31 billion in Q1 FY21, a degrowth of 62.1%. Consequently, profit after tax stood at rupees 1.52 billion in Q1 FY22 as compared to rupees 3.98 billion in Q1 FY21, a degrowth of 61.9%. ROE was 8.1% in Q1 FY22 as compared to 25.1% in Q1 FY21. Solvency ratio was 2.76 at June 30, 2021 as against 2.9 times at March 31, 2021, continued to be higher than the regulatory minimum of 1.5 times. Insofar as the progress in relation to the scheme of arrangement with Bharti AXA is concerned, we received the NCLT approval during the quarter and we await the IRDAI final approval in the matter. The expenses incurred of rupees 0.06 billion have been absorbed in the P&L during Q1 FY2022. As I conclude, I would like to reiterate that we continue to stay focused on building a profitable growth and sustainable value creation, and would like to thank you all for attending this earnings conference call, and we'll be happy to take any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star 1 on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to withdraw yourself from the question queue, you may press star and 2. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Deepika Mundra from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
Hello, good evening, sir. Thanks for taking my question. I hope everyone is well. So just on the IBNR, if I see the results in the P&L, it reflects that the IBNR is up, I think, from 5.4 billion to 11.4 billion. But you mentioned that on the health side, the IBNR is just about 2 billion as part of the 6 billion odd claims. So can you help reconcile that? What is the increase for? And secondly, the 15 to 20% increase in pricing on group health, has that already gone through or is it expected to go through in the near future?
So let me answer the second question first and a bit of the first, and then I'll ask Gopal to cover the rest. So the since we saw the COVID numbers you know, spiking, and one of the points that we both of us made is that this time the pattern is a bit different in the sense that the tail is seems to be thicker, in the sense that the reimbursement claim percentage is a bit higher, which means some of the claims are getting reported a bit late compared to what we saw in wave one. So that has been a bit, and you figured this out in time, right? You cannot anticipate this a priority. So what we did was, when we were beginning to see these numbers going up, we started recalibrating our pricing. And as we speak, to answer your question, Deepika, yes, the pricing has, whatever we are writing now, in the group health side, we are writing at a higher price. So we have two types, two, three types, different segments. One is we have, you know, the low, you know, the SME segment, which we keep talking about, right, where we write smaller groups. There, it's a more gradual price increase that we do in any case, and there also we've done a price increase. For large accounts, we, you know, these numbers are more relevant for the large account. There, those price increases are going through, you know, of course, client-specific, but that's going through. Coming back to your question on IBNR, the number that Gopal gave specifically for the COVID impact, which is in a sense related to last quarter, a bit of a one-off, but the overall aggregate numbers are the aggregate IBNR numbers. But I'll ask Gopal to clarify the breakup.
Yeah. So Deepika, I think what you're seeing is basically the change in the IBNR over different periods. Now, that's obviously a function of payments that would have also happened out of the IBNR reserves that you create. And hence, to that extent, when you compare between periods, you may not be really be able to get a like-to-like comparison. Let's say, for example, whatever IBNR that you would have reserved in, let's say, Q1 last year, a lot of it would have already kind of maybe got settled during this last 12-month period. And incremental IBNR, what we create, not just for health, while we put out the numbers specifically in the context of health, as a part of the same LODR reporting that you are referring to, there is also information that is available with respect to the outstanding IBNR that is existing for each of the segments. So what you see as a change in IBNR is purely a position between periods that can undergo a change basis the actual claim payments that happens across different segments. A better outcome would be to maybe look at more, maybe the loss ratio numbers between different segments, which comprises of both IBNR plus the claims that has got paid during the respective periods. And on that basis, if you would have seen, I think as a part of the investor presentation, which we have put out segment by segment, what is the change that we have seen in so far as the overall loss ratio movements are concerned.
Okay. Just a follow-up to that, just on growing the health business, both in group and in retail, how thinking about it in context of a potential?
We cannot hear you.
We couldn't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Better. Yeah, better.
Okay. So I just wanted to understand the thought process on growing the health business in the context of a potential, you know, third wave, if any. And secondly, would the reserves be accounting for future losses, the ones which are just beyond this IBNR also?
Yeah, so again, your second question first. Have we factored and created a reserve for a potential third wave of COVID? The answer is no. We can't do that. We cannot create a reserve for some claim event that will happen in the future. What we can do is create a, be conservative and reserve for the IBNR based on actuarial and statistical models. That's what we have done for health, and as we've said, our principle is that when we know of an adverse effect, we take the full hit upfront. When we also know of a beneficial effect, we don't take the full hit upfront. So let's say on the motor OD side, we, like last year, we have stayed with the same principle of spreading the benefit over a period. And if you look at, let's say last year, just to amplify the point, if you look at last year, ICICI Lombard's motor loss ratio in Q and for the full year was similar, roughly about 65-66%. For the industry, the first quarter loss ratio on motor was 67%. For the whole year was 75%. It just tells you the principle that we follow, which is, you know, again, we've discussed this many times, so we've been conservative in that sense. But we cannot anticipate a future event and provide for it. That is not, allowed in our regulation either. Now, coming to your point on third wave, so, you know, we've taken a fat tail in the IBNR on the COVID, but whether a third wave will come and what number will happen, that we have not anticipated. In our future expectation and estimation, we are anyway assuming a continued tail of COVID cases. So, for example, right now we are seeing 40,000 cases, 40,000 infections in the country incrementally every single day. Now, whether that will continue for too long or not, but we don't know, but there is that number. So we are assuming that for a future outlook, but not in the reserving.
Yeah, I think the only thing that I will just add on, I think when we also did the estimation of IBNR, as we kind of put out as a part of the opening remarks, this wave specifically, Deepika, we have clearly seen the tail of reporting to be relatively longer, given the fact that the number of intimations have been substantially on the increase. So we have seen, let's say, for example, the proportion of intimations that would have come through reimbursement is far higher than the proportion of reimbursements that we have seen insofar as wave one intimations are concerned. And secondly, we have also seen the reporting time period within which a customer logs in for a reimbursement claim. That also under wave one has seen an increase in comparison to what we had seen under wave one. So that's the reason why factoring in for this relatively longer thick tail of claims and the claim pattern that we have observed during wave two in comparison to wave one is what we have kind of factored in for that incremental IBNR of 2.18 billion. Obviously, we will have to wait and see how the development plays out as we see over the next few months and kind of factor in for the appropriate impact thereof.
Understood, sir. Thank you so much.
And to your first question, in so far as the investments in health, I think that's clearly, we have always articulated health as an area of opportunity. I think both, whether it is in the context of employer-employee, obviously we have always kind of played that particular segment tactically over a period of time, depending on the underlying environment that's operating in the market. But on the retail side, clearly as we have spoken over the past several quarters, that's clearly an area where we think there is enough and more continued investments in distribution that we can do. And that's where, again, we believe this is the right time, given the potential that segment has. We are kind of going ahead with making that incremental investment of expanding our workforce, particularly on the frontline distribution, by additional 1,000 people, who in turn obviously will be kind of significantly working towards expanding the distribution force. Because at the end of the day, if you look at on the retail health specifically, the extent of market share that we would have is a single digit number. And we believe there is a long headroom for growth in that segment. And these are times where we need to continue to make our investments in expanding that particular portfolio.
And just to add to one comment on your point on your concern on third wave in that context. So when we build a team, we don't see incremental business revenues come through immediately. So by the time the team comes in and starts becoming productive, effectively we'll see a business impact really next year. So if, worst case, if we see another wave this year, I don't think there's any incremental risk because of this.
Got it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ajok Cedric from BNK Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity, sir. Sir, my question is again with respect to the IBNR. Are we factoring in till 30th June? So that's what is the IBNR computing for the claims which are not yet intimated, or are we assuming a tail going forward and that is also factored in part of IBNR?
So, Ajox, to answer your point, as Bhargav explained, I think insofar as the regulation is concerned, we can largely kind of reserve for any claims. As the term IBNR indicates, these are claims that are likely to have incurred or happened during the quarter, but for which, let's say, a reporting has not happened. That's the provisions that we carry in our financials. So the number of the 2.18 billion that you have seen is predominantly for the intimations, given the points that I spoke about in response to the earlier question that Deepika had asked. It is to kind of factor in for any likely delay in intimations, which are expected to happen in the months of, let's say, July, August, or September, or maybe even thereafter, for likely admissions or claim that would have happened in quarter one.
Okay. So these claims have already, the cases have already happened in 1Q, and for that you are, okay, got it, sir. So now coming to the second part of that question, which is, like you said, going forward it's difficult to estimate and so on and so forth. But you might have done some back of the envelope computation to be prepared for it. What is the sense you are in? Just for me, I'm getting a sense like around 200 to 50 odd courses yet to come in. Of course, a very good computation. But have you done any internal math, and can you reveal from that angle?
Yeah, we've done our modeling. I mean, like every time we do this, but honestly, estimating the time and the ferocity of wave 3 is really challenging. And, you know, again, there are, as you know, multiple views on whether it will happen, or even if it happens, will we have the UK experience where, because of higher vaccination, the hospitalization will be lower, etc. These are, you know, really, you can throw up multiple numbers meaning with the small tweaks in the assumption on the wave 3. So
I was more talking about the current sales, like Gopal was telling, 40,000, you were telling 40,000 cases per day. So
the current sales, as Gopal explained, you know, what we've seen is because there has been slightly more higher proportion of reimbursement claims and there is some amount of delay, whenever there is these uncertainties, a good actuary gets more conservative. So they do build what is known as margin for adverse deviation. So that is all built into this IBNR number. Now, in reality, if the numbers prove to be lower than what we do, that will come through and get released. But as of now, we believe that's an appropriate reserve.
All right. Sir, and on the price hike front, any thought process on the retail side? And are we expected to go slow given the current scenario, probably as a tactical call on the retail side?
So tactically, we have been kind of, you know, we take the tactical calls in, you know, more the group portfolios. That's why I made that point in the beginning that we've been a bit cautious because we were beginning to, you know, see this towards the end of last year, early this, you know, beginning of the quarter. But in retail, you know, we believe that it is important for us to stay invested in a distribution and a channel. You know, this is insurance, right? There will be a quarter where maybe a big cat event will happen. I mean, pandemic is something that doesn't happen in every other day, but, you know, when it happens, it happens. But we have to stay invested in building the distribution and stay, you know, with that strategy. Having said that, we were a bit more cautious about adding the headcount that we've added now, simply because we've seen, you know, two waves, maybe another wave three will happen, and thereafter, at least we are hoping that things will stabilize a bit. So this investment will start, you know, delivering, you know, top line growth really from next year onwards. So that, if you can call it a tactical call, that's a tactical call. But otherwise, we want to stay invested in the health side, in the retail health side.
Got it, sir. I'll join back in the queue. So thank you. Thanks for that explanation.
Thanks, Ajox.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants, please limit your question to two per participant. If you have a follow-up question, you may rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Pratik Poda from Nippon India Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Sir, I just wanted to understand this 218 crores. If you can just give us some flavor as to how do we project this? And, you know, just taking this forward, look, we have 40,000 cases every day. You had a 4% market share, as you talked about in your opening comments. Does that mean that 100 cases a day is something which is theoretically our size of claims, which might come to us in the worst case, and that can easily get absorbed going forward? Is that the way to think about it? That's question number one. And second is, sir, if you have taken a 20% price hike as mentioned in your PPT, then does that mean that from a volume growth perspective, health has seen a 20% volume degrowth on a YOY basis? And lastly, sir, motor growth has been quite slow this quarter, but despite you mentioning that there was only a partial lockdown. So I didn't understand why was that so. Yeah, so those are the three questions.
Thanks, Pratik. So let me try to clarify the first, answer the first question and clarify this piece, as well as I can. So let's look at data, right? So if you look at, as a nation in the country, for the whole year, there was roughly about 12 million COVID claims. This first quarter, as a nation, there was 18 million COVID claims. COVID cases. Let me clarify. 12 million COVID cases. First quarter, India saw 18 million COVID cases.
Okay.
The total industry claims, so all of them, just to explain that 40,000 doesn't mean, everyone will claim. So out of this 12 million cases of COVID last year in the country, industry saw 986,000 cases of claims.
Okay.
Okay. Now in Q1, the industry saw 1,051,000 claims.
Okay.
So it's not as if every person effectively claims, right? So because usual penetration issue, etc., of health insurance. Now, if you now look at again comparing with the last year first quarter numbers, just for us, I'm now turning to our numbers. Last year first quarter we had 1,317 COVID-19 cases. First quarter last year. This year first quarter we have 46,136 cases. Almost more than 30 times, about 35 times, right? What we've also seen is the percentage of reimbursement cases are higher this time than what we saw in, wave one. Now, the percentage of reimbursement we can't predict at the beginning of the wave because we are just seeing the cashless claims, right? So when, let's say, we get cashless claims of 100 in the first week or first month, we believe that will be similar to last time. So last time maybe there was about 50% reimbursement, 50% cashless. We are assuming similar numbers will happen. But by June, we are getting a better picture for the April book because people start filing the reimbursement claims. And we are beginning to see that the reimbursement percentage is higher this time than what we saw last time.
Okay.
A good actuary looks at this pattern change and there is still data insufficiency for all the claims that people who have actually got hospitalized may not have claimed in from Q1. So we create a reserve which is IBNR, incurred, as in the hospitalization has happened, but the claim hasn't been reported to us. So that is IBNR. Now in IBNR, the actuary also kind of creates some cushion, which is called margin for adverse deviation, from what is his model showing as the best estimate, and he holds a certain cushion. And whenever there is this amount of uncertainty, usually that margin for adverse deviation cushion is slightly higher. So that's what the actuary has done, which is to look at this pattern of claims, the volumes, etc. And, while intimated claims are, the 384 numbers, he's held an incremental IBNR of 200 plus. In due as all claims get reported, all reimbursement claims come through in the month of July, August, for the first quarter, by the way, we will get to know maybe within 2 to 3 months what is the full picture. Now, if the number is less, then that will get released. Coming back to your next question of going ahead, 40,000 cases, that will lead to what number of claims. It depends on which market the cases come from. If it's big city, it will be higher percentage, and all of those factors will come in. So, difficult to predict what the numbers will be. Coming back to your question on motor. And before that question on
health pricing. health pricing, yeah, volume degrowth of 20%.
Yeah, no, we didn't have a volume degrowth. We can separately give you the numbers, but the price increase that I'm talking about didn't happen from April onwards. You know, we are talking about seeing price increase towards the latter half of the quarter, and more importantly now. We'll give you the volume number in due course. And in retail, we didn't see that kind of a price increase. It was a smaller price increase because we took a price increase on our core indemnity, product back in, November for the new and for renewal in January. That was already taken last year. Coming back to your last question on motor, yes, our market share was slightly, tad muted in Q1. There was a couple of impacts. One is that, we have typically a slightly larger share of new as a company.
Okay, got it.
Gets affected, we also get affected, and we had two consecutive years of that. So last year, new sales didn't happen. So the renewal book for us in this quarter, based on last year's book, is also low. My sense is it's temporary. I think by this quarter, we should be back on track, is our sense. We are not overtly worried about motor market share.
Got it. Sir, one question if I may squeeze in. Someone who has got COVID last year, let's say those 1379 cases, when they come up for renewals, do they take higher sum assured and do you charge a higher pricing? Because he has COVID, so are you being slightly more conservative in terms of giving him a higher price? I'm just trying to ask, like, behaviorally, are you seeing a higher sum assured?
As per regulation, we cannot deny. But what we do is, as I said, the retail portfolio pricing happens on a portfolio basis. So we go back to the regulator, portfolio, we ask for price increase, which we had done in, as I said, November of last year. So that price increase, the customer will pay. So that's our pricing. The sum assured increase, we have anecdotally seen, often I don't have the numbers, but anecdotally we have seen, higher proportion of upselling on sum insured that we are seeing in the retail portfolio and the indemnity. But if you want separately, we can give you that.
No problem, sir. Thank you so much. All the best.
Thank you. Participants are requested to please limit your question to two per participant. The next question is from the line of Neeraj Toshniwal from UBS. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. So my two questions. First is on the health itself. So this 46,000 cases in 384 is based on 384 crore total. That is, our ticket size is kind of increased by 4.6% compared to what we had in FY21. So severity is also kind of increasing because of the fact that probably, as you said, it is requiring a longer, the expenses have been higher on the given the hospitalization which had been there this time.
It's
so is the understanding correct?
Sorry, we couldn't understand your question properly. If you could just repeat yourself a bit slowly, it's a bit unclear. Voice.
So the so my question is whether severity has also increased the ticket size in this quarter for you guys, while because the average ticket size was 79,800 and on 384 crores on 46,000, the ticket size moved to 83,478. So it's on the, though it's still below than the industry, but I think it has increased for us, the ticket size payouts, average per claim.
No, so Neeraj, I think on claim severity, as we explained, definitely even at the part of our opening remarks, what we had indicated was compared to wave one, the proportion of cases that we have seen on the wave two with respect to, let's say, mild or critical cases, that has definitely seen an increase. So that by itself kind of moderate and critical cases has clearly seen an increase compared to wave one. So that by itself kind of increases the overall average claim size. So that's one. The second is, in general, I think the extent of medical procedures that were performed in wave two as compared to wave one, given the intensity of the virus that had attacked in this wave, was also definitely higher. So hence, that extent, that also led to an increase in so far as claim severity is concerned. To some extent, the reason why you see more or less a balanced number is primarily because, as we also mentioned, the extent of the length of stay that we have seen during this particular wave 2 as compared to wave 1 has seen some kind of a reduction in the number of days. So in that sense, it's a balanced outcome insofar as ACS is what we have seen. But yes, there is definitely an increase in claim severity. on those points that I spoke about. And the extent of severity again has varied between geographies. I mean, for example, if you look at some of the metro cities, as we know, Delhi, Karnataka, Mumbai, Tamil Nadu, I think clearly these were four geographies where we had also seen a significant increase in number of intimations. And there the extent of billings that we have seen insofar as average claim sizes are concerned, that was definitely on an increase. But on balance, I think when you look at the overall book, I think given a combination of what I spoke, the average claim size seems to be more or less on the similar lines as what we had experienced in the whole of, in comparison to wave one. But definitely, we have seen instances of increase in claim severity.
Got it. And the second question is the motor. We started taking small price increases. What is the current scenario? Can you help with us on that? I mean, how is the price increase happening around?
So, Niraj, the market remains competitive. So, and I think the market has seen, like last time, some amount of benefit because of, you know, the temporary lockdown that some states did in this phase. So, you know, some of these are a bit sticky. So we have not seen the market shift in line with what we expected. Our sense is that it will take a bit of time, but it has to happen because the OD side is, you know, I think extremely competitive right now.
Okay, that is helpful. Thank you. That's my question.
Thanks, Neeraj.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Madhukar Ladha from Elara Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, evening, and thank you for taking my question. So I wanted to understand that given the current number of cases, let's say 40,000 a day, and, you know, your modeling, for the next 9 months, July onwards, what sort of loss ratio in health one can expect? Let's say if the current situation stays the way it is, then what would be sort of the new normal? Or does that move significantly from what we used to see, let's say, in the previous year?
Yeah, so, you know, honestly, again, as I said, it's very, very difficult to predict the virology and the timing and the extent of the wave. So I will not comment on that. But because we've not even assuming that in the base situation at this point in time, that can be you know, something that we will have to watch for. But in a BAU basis, on a base case basis, also there is a bit of increase in ACS, that, you know, average claim size that we are seeing, the claim severity that we are seeing for even non-COVID cases. Fundamentally, because what has happened in the hospitals is that there is some amount of increase in, you know, treatment costs because of maybe consumable charges, the PPE kits that they use, you know, some other, you know, extra tests, etc., that is happening. So there is a slight increase in the ACS for even non-COVID. So, you know, keeping COVID aside, which is very difficult to predict, even non-COVID, we are seeing some increase, which is why we feel it's appropriate to ask, go for a price increase. On the particular group health side, and you know, hopefully the retail increase that we've taken should address our you know, our objectives on the balance of the loss ratio. But I think there will be a slight shift up in the overall loss ratio for health book, even apart from the one-off COVID impact that we've seen in Q1. Exact quantification difficult to tell you, but we are expecting some increase.
Understood. So, and, you know, there were a lot of numbers, you know, mentioned. I may have missed, you know, something, or, you know, I don't know whether that's already there in the presentation. But, you know, what was the number, that 46,000 number is what we got in 1Q FY22. And what was the number for the full year?
So last year, first quarter, so you're right, 46,136 was the number of claims that got intimated for COVID in first quarter of this year. Last whole year, for us, it was 49,266. Last year, first quarter, you know, the corresponding quarter, the number was 1,317.
Thank you. All the best.
Thanks, Madhukar.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nideshin from Investec. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity, sir. If I look at the COVID claims impact in this quarter is around 600 odd crores. If I just add that to PBT, that becomes a very large number. So is the benefit we probably have got on the non-COVID claims in the health vertical? I'm just trying to understand what could be the normalized profitability had COVID not been there.
So if you look at Nidesh, again, as a part of the opening remarks, what we had indicated was unlike wave one, where we had actually seen reduction in non-COVID health intimations, for example. If you look at wave two, which is for the current quarter, the extent of non-COVID health intimations are at almost 90% of the level of, let's say, a business as usual quarter, which is something, I mean, in the normal course, you would have expected that whenever the COVID cases is at its peak, you would have expected, let's say, the non-COVID health intimations to have actually seen a reasonable decline in intimations. But something that we have seen in this particular quarter. So hence, on so far as non-COVID health benefit, as I said, because it's pretty much back to almost 90% of intimations to a BAU quarter, we have not seen any significant benefit insofar as reduction in claims is concerned. So that's so far as the health picture is concerned. On the motor side, I mean, since you're talking specifically about benefits, on motor, again, the picture is pretty much similar. I mean, a better comparison is maybe quarter one of last year. Quarter two comparison may not be relevant, at least for motor, because in quarter two last year, we had more or less seen the economic activities kind of opening up and claim intimations on motor were pretty much back to normal. So hence, a better comparison will be to look at it from a quarter one of last year, where there was a complete lockdown. Now, at that point of time, the number of intimations that we had seen on motor own damage claim, that number was roughly at about 37% of, let's say, a normal business as usual quarter, around that 37% level. Whereas if you look at the quarter one of the current year, the trend line is similar to what I spoke on non-COVID health, wherein we have not necessarily seen as much of a decline in intimations. In fact, we have seen an increase of almost about 75% increase in number of claims. Or if I were to put the other way around, we have almost seen about 65 to 68% of intimations in this particular quarter in comparison to a normal business as usual quarter. So again, we have not seen as much of a benefit in motor own damage claims as well in comparison to the last quarter one of FY21. And in while there is a benefit, but the way we have continued to recognize this benefit is the similar approach what we followed the last year, which is to be prudent insofar as recognizing the benefits entirely in this particular quarter. Rather, there is a possibility that some of this could kind of come back or maybe see an increase in the subsequent quarters. And hence, again, as we put out even as a part of our opening remarks, wherever we see maybe an adverse development, we generally, as a matter of prudence, tend to take from an actuarial standpoint the whole of the impact in that particular period. But wherever we see any benefits, we again try to be prudent in looking at recognizing the benefit over a period of time. So when you look at the numbers now for the quarter one, while on the health side, you saw an impact of about 602 crores. The benefit that I spoke about on the motor was roughly at about 60 crores. So on a net basis, what we have seen is about 540 crores of impact in this particular quarter.
So in that context, our profit would have been 500 crores if this higher than 500 crores if this would not have hit us, if COVID would not have hit us.
Yeah, so we had a good quarter on the investment side relative to last year, because if you see, we are particularly elevated. So that, of course, was a bit of a one-off as well.
Yeah, understood. And secondly, on the app, we have got around 7 lakh downloads. Can you share some more details about the monthly active users and how are we planning to cross-sell to these customers that have downloaded this app?
So that's a great question. So that's what we are kind of building up for. So if you go back to the thought process behind this app, it was started for our group health customers, because normally we have a relationship with a corporate we don't build a relationship with the actual consumer or actual customer. So this started with that, and then we gradually have kept pivoting, and now it's built as an app for all our customers. It's an engagement app for all our customers. And the whole thought process is that, you know, this in the long term would, one, create better retention and renewals, as also potential upsell cross-sell. Right now the focus was largely building the service platform and the partnership platform to provide some of these services. So for example, teleconsult, this is something that we wanted to be rolled out from through this app. So these were things that were not necessarily focusing on upsell cross-sell, but again giving more service and features to customers. That was the focus. Very recently, in the last quarter, we've now added the buy policy feature, only on the Android phone. We've not done it for the iOS. And we've now begun to see some decent traction in terms of numbers. Just to give you some sense, in terms of the teleconsult, what I talked about, even as recently as Q4 of last year, we had roughly about 1,685 teleconsults. First quarter, we had 7,685 teleconsults. I mean, these are not revenue numbers, but it's just engagement numbers that are picking up. As of now, the cross-sell, upsell numbers are very small because, as I said, in fact, towards the latter half of the quarter, we kind of added the buying flow capability. But we are quite optimistic about, this piece going forward.
Sure. And last question on the retail health. So industry is growing at 40%, 35%. This was a very good quarter in terms of awareness about health insurance segment. And we have also taken price hike last year. But despite that, our retail indemnity health growth has been quite low versus what industry is growing. So now you are saying that you'll be adding 1,000 people. So should we start hoping that we will start growing in line with the industry going forward?
So Nidesh, that's definitely an area of investments for us, and that's precisely the reason why we spoke about our continued thrust of expanding distribution in retail health specifically. And that's where, even if you see the aggregate number of agents that we were able to work with, this is of course the company number. You would have seen that the total number of agents, which includes the point of sale distribution, to be at about 61,000 plus, which is up from about 59,000. Now this number could have actually been slightly higher, but for certain challenges that we had insofar as enrollment of agents, given the pandemic wave that we have seen in this particular quarter, that impacted everyone. I mean, even in terms of agents who would have been available for enrollment, getting them licensed, our own people, as we kind of put out, almost 10% of our workforce was impacted as a result of this virus. Now all of that obviously had some impact insofar as growth of the retail health portfolio when you look at the quarter one numbers specifically. But honestly, I think this continues to be one of our preferred segments, and we would want to kind of, as I said, leverage on the growth potential what we see, and want to make those incremental additions to the workforce of about 1,000 people, which in turn, as Bhargav explained, the benefit of incremental revenues, again, is something that we will start to see flowing through maybe from the next financial year onwards.
Also to add to that, Gopal, Sanjeev here, there are three categories, on the health indemnity side. One is SAHI, another is PSU, and there is private sector, which is multi-line companies. So SAHI, of course, have grown from at more than 50%, and the arbitrage that is available in terms of the access to agent, which we have restricted, and because of the pandemic, the exams were not happening. And otherwise also, yes, with this arbitrage, they were able to build a large distribution. The multi-line companies on an average have grown in at 23%, while we have grown at 28%, and the PSUs have grown at 20%. So if you see the cohort-wise, we have been ahead of the cohort in which we are operating, and with this investment, we believe that we'll be able to increase the market share going forward.
Sure. And so lastly, these investments that
Mr. Jain, may I request you to please rejoin the queue? We have participants waiting for the
turn.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vinod Rajmani from HSBC. Please go ahead.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, Vinod, we can hear you.
Yeah, yeah. So just two questions actually, both related to the health segment. So if I take the IBNR outstanding claims reserve numbers for health and personal accidents for March 31st, 2021, and if I take it for the first quarter in the release, not in the investor separate, the P&L below the P&L. So that number I get as I get at 5.786 billion, which is 186,468 minus 128,608. And if I look at the IBNR that you have provided in the results in the presentation, you have said it is 6.02.
So Vinod, one, when you're looking at the numbers, again, when you're looking at the outstanding IBNR numbers, as I explained, whatever IBNR numbers that you would see as of 31st of March, some of those would have kind of got settled during the quarter, and hence to that extent that you would have seen a reduction in the IBNR numbers. And okay, incrementally, whatever claims have got reported, again, in this particular quarter, that's why we gave the impact of about 602 crores. This is in the context of COVID that I'm talking about. What okay, you are talking about of the IBNR numbers, what you see as a part of the LODR filing, is the IBNR picture for the overall health book, which includes a combination of IBNR for the retail portfolio as well as the employer-employee portfolio as well. Now,
understood.
At any point of time, when you look at the reserving or let's say claim intimations, as and when the claims gets intimated, there is a particular process that we follow insofar as settlement, and on that basis, either the claims will be a part of claims paid, or in the event if there are actual cases that have been intimated yet to be settled, that will be a part of case reserves. And beyond this is where there is an actuarial estimate that happens, which is with respect to IBNR reserves. Now, hence, when you look at the number of the outstanding position, let's say as at 30th of June, it would include maybe certain cases of IBNRs, which is yet to be settled, that's one. And two, for the whole of the health book, whatever IBNR that we have created is forming a part of the outstanding number. So it is not necessarily a like-to-like comparison that you can do in terms of the IBNR outstanding as of 31st March vis-a-vis, let's say, an IBNR outstanding as of 30th of June.
Understood. And the second question is, in the first wave, how much of the IBNR provisions were later reversed? Just some rough percentage as to on the health side, how much of the IBNR provisions that you took in the first during the first wave, how much of that was later reversed?
So honestly, I think at this point of time, I think we don't have a specific number around it. But generally, I think we can possibly put this in the context of the full year numbers, not necessarily in the context of wave one. As we had kind of put out for the whole of the year, insofar as our books is concerned, we had an impact of about 3.39 billion, which included all those three components that I spoke about, whether it is claims paid, claims reserves, or whether it is with respect to IBNR. As we see the intimations coming through in this particular quarter, our view is whatever we had reserved for, I think as of now, we have not completely consumed it. But we believe we are kind of quite sufficient to address any intimations that could come in the subsequent period for an IBNR reserve that is outstanding as of 31st of March.
If I can just add one more comment, it also depends on which cycle of the tail you close the book. So if you look at last year, the peak was in September. And by March, almost everything was done. So you didn't need too much of an IBNR.
Okay, yeah.
Because the numbers were very, very low at that point in time. The peak numbers would have all got reported and paid off, etc. Now, in June, it's a different picture altogether. May was a peak and June was pretty bad. So, when there is so much of uncertainty, the margin that you hold for adverse deviation risk is usually higher. Now, will it be released or not? Only time will tell. It's very difficult for us to tell you that, you know, X percentage of that will get released. If we knew that, then we wouldn't have even held it.
Understood. I was just trying to get a sense versus the first wave. What was the, you know, in terms of the provisioning that you did, how much of the IBNR got released in the first wave on the health side?
Yeah, so that's what I said. That's what both of us explained, that, you know, it depends on when you created the idea.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for that. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Suresh Ganpati from Macquarie. Please go ahead.
Yeah, just two quick questions. One is your loss ratio of 150% plus in the health segment. What could be the industry loss ratio if you were to just take a guesstimate? Are you higher, lower than the industry?
We wouldn't know that, honestly. We can only tell you the number of claims intimated for the industry, for which there's a public data.
Okay. So that's okay. Yeah, okay. And one last question on this, this reserving thing. So there is no way that you can make any contingency reserve in the sense that in case you're going to see some abnormal behavior in the month of July, August, because your cutoff is 30th of June. So IBNR, all reserving is done as on 30th of June based on your estimation of what could be the incurred but not reported and stuff. But then at the end of the day, if there is an abnormal pattern of claims in the month of July, August, September relative to the history, the regulator or the accounting standards don't allow you to make any contingency reserve. Have I got this correct? BDG
and Suresh, if you look at, because the financials are prepared as of 30th of June, and one is expected to factor in for all actions that have taken place for the quarter to be accounted for in this particular period. So that's the reason why we also build that element of IBNR. In the normal course, one would have argued to say that I would take only claims that have been paid in the period, or maybe for the matter of fact, claims that have actually been intimated and reserved for on a case-to-case basis. But over and above that, what the accounting standards and the actuarial principles require is to kind of estimate for the period for which the financials are drawn up, also determine an element of claim that presumably has happened in that quarter, which in our case is quarter one for this particular period. And however, there is a possibility that the customer could end up intimating the claim in the subsequent months. The subsequent intimations, or let's say a loss admission or a claim that has happened for a customer, let's say in the month of July or August or September, that will be recognized as a part of Q2 financials.
Okay. Pretty clear. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Suresh.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, this was the last question for today. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Bhargav Dasgupta for closing comments.
No, just let me close by thanking all of you for joining us. Take care of yourselves, stay healthy, stay safe. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. On behalf of ICICI Lombard General Insurance, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.